You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, I'm Bill DeLuca. Welcome to Theater 100, our class on television, film, and theater. Welcome to this rainy day in Southern California. Today we have a great program. We're looking at directing, and I have a special guest coming in the second half of the show, Kelly Herman, to talk to you about directing. In fact, we'll talk a little bit about her production of Little Prince, but we're also going to talk a little bit about some of the history of Greek and Roman theater. So we have a lot to accomplish today. But it is an interactive medium, theater, as well as film and television, so hopefully we'll hear from you today. Feel free to call us on our toll-free number, 1-800-339-1193, if you want to pose a question to me or Kelly once she comes in the second half, or just make an insight of your own. Really appreciate hearing from you, or logging onto our internet site there, askdhtvlive@gmail.com. And as some of our students will do, they'll pose a question or make a comment, so feel free to join us either by phone or through the internet. In fact, just to encourage you to do so, we have a focus question for today, and that is, what does the stage director do? Describe one of the many functions that the director is responsible for, and as you know, the director is responsible for many, many functions, so I'm asking you to kind of choose one. What do you think is perhaps the most important thing that a director can do for a show? We're talking primarily about theater today, but that could include film and television as well. So what do you think the director does? What's one of the most important functions that the director does? That'll be our focus question for today. I just want to cover some details before we go into history. Our students are probably just absolutely rapturous about the fact that there are no discussion boards this week. We've had 3 weeks of discussion boards based on what you read in the, what you see in the broadcast and what you read in the text, but there are none this week, and there's a reason for that. I'm trying to encourage you to get ready to write your Raisin in the Sun character analysis, and that's going to take some time, so that's why I didn't want you doing the discussion board this week and focusing on reading that play, because it is a very long play. You may have seen televised productions of it before, that's fine, but I really want you to read the whole play, and it takes a while, so it's easy to get. You can probably find it online as well, so I want you to start digging into that. And if I could maybe draw your attention to the Blackboard site for a minute, if you look at the weekly module site that we have on Raisin in the Sun, this is next week, we're in week 6 now, but on week 7, it basically gives you the directions here on writing it, but here are the actual specific directions that are there in your writing guidelines. So please do look through this, because a lot of this is what we're expecting. And at the bottom, this is where you would submit your first writing assignment for the class. So I'm taking the time just to show that to you so that you're kind of clear on how to go about it. But yes, there's ways that a playwright can give us character. After all, you don't write a play, you don't read a play when you sit in the audience, you are watching a show. So the actors have to find ways to show that. It begins with the playwright's work, and Lorraine Hansberry was excellent at being able to craft ways that the character comes through. Obviously, what a character looks like tells you a lot about who they are. What other characters say about them tells you who they are. And sometimes what they do speaks louder than words. So yes, actions speak louder than words. Think of the dramatic action that the character takes in the play. And that tells you a lot about who they are. So that's why there's no discussion board this week. You won't see any of those large graphics that say discussion board focus item, which I usually have 4 or 5 that tell you what to write about for the discussion board. There's no discussion board this week. So enjoy that, but also dig into Raisin in the Sun, and also realize that after we do Raisin, we go right into the midterm exams. So the exams start March 12th, the whole week of week 8 in this class gives you the chance to take the online class. I talked to a student this week who hasn't bought the textbook yet. So I'm wondering how possibly it might work out that you could pass the midterm exam. So feel free to do what you need to do right now to get ready for these two major assignments coming up. Raisin in the Sun, your first writing assignment, and the midterm exam. They're all right around the corner. So just that kind warning. Also, for those of you who are trying to see Before It Hits Home, very sorry, but it's sold out. The show has done so well on campus. It is very much about issues relevant to not just African-American families, but to all families. So unfortunately, I have to say, if you were hoping to see it, you're going to lose the chance. You really needed to get your tickets early. However, we do have another show that's opening up. I will bring you the poster for that as well and send it out to you in the next room. And that doesn't open until early April. But if you want to wait and use that for your production review, in other words, the show that you see that you write about for this class, that's a good one too. And that is performed in our 500-seat theater. So you shouldn't have a problem getting a seat for In the Next Room. So sorry about Before It Hits Home, but sometimes theater gets to be a very popular thing, and people, word of mouth helps it to sell. So yeah, we're very pleased with the production, but sorry to have to turn people away. That's tough. Okay, as I said, one of the things that we like to do is to look back at history just to almost give us a sense of where we are now. So it's not just to provide a history lesson. It's not going to be on the midterm, but it does help us to have our own perspective on theater and what's important about it. So we're going to look at some of the highlights of Greek and Roman theater a little bit briefly before we start talking about directing. There is a great image of the Theater of Dionysius that goes back to the 4th century BC when, you may remember from last week, Aristotle was sitting out there in that audience taking notes and writing what would become the Poetics that would help define what goes into a play, what the characters, the plot, the language, the spectacle, the music, all the elements of the drama he derived from this arrangement. And the neat thing about Greek theater is that we're looking at performances that have to do with social expression. And that can be, they're all derived from mythological stories. So the characters that you're seeing in front of you are gods, the gods that have been told, that parents have told their children about in stories. Now you're actually getting to see Athena on stage. You're getting to see Antigone on stage. So the great mythological stories. And realize too, this is religion. I mean, in this world, these characters represent a belief system that is very powerful for the Greeks. In fact, it's called the Theater of Dionysius because the whole drama was dedicated to one god, the god Dionysus, and he has this unusual ability to change shape. He could change into the shape of a woman. He could change into the shape of an animal. He was this transformative deity, which makes him perfect as the kind of patron of actors. In fact, the first acting union that we know of was called the Craftsmen of Dionysius. So it is very much a religious festival. And there's a week-long celebrations, but it is dedicated to a religious purpose. And perhaps for that idea, the Greeks were very drawn to idealism. If you ever looked at any of the Greek artwork that is done, the characters are anthropomorphic, not animal-based, human-based, and they're quite beautiful. In fact, this is the first time that we see freestanding nudes anywhere in the world. And that is perhaps a celebration of a newfound freedom. Now, that didn't necessarily apply totally to the political system, although this is the origins of democracy, and that did help Greece to have a certain power. Not everyone was a citizen, realize, in this world. But a lot of what was done on stage was to show what the ideal situation was. So it wasn't meant to be realistic. It wasn't meant to be about everyday people. It was how the gods live and misbehave. The gods were very human in Greek times. So there were a lot of lessons learned by watching the interplay of the gods. So when you look at a play like the Oresteia by Aeschylus, you see a play that is basically tackling a huge social problem. What do we do with the problems of revenge? That story is about a son revenging himself on the mother who has revenged herself on the father. It's a whole sequence of revenge and how to stop it. Oddly enough, that play poses that the solution is in having a jury of 12 citizens to decide the fate of that particular person. So a lot of social issues came to the fore in Greek theater. Also, the setting, as you see in this particular image, I think we have some other images that we could see as well, is very natural. The Greeks put everyone in kind of a huge three-quarter arrangement so that when you're watching a show in one part of the auditorium, outside, this is an outside amphitheater, right? You are looking at the performers in front of you, but you are seeing the audience on the other side as well. So you are part of a community. You never lose the fact that you are one of many witnessing this story. It's kind of like a storytelling situation where you're aware of everybody else listening. It's not like film where you want to be alone watching that film. It's an individual experience. The Greeks really introduced this concept of theater as a communal activity. And a lot of the techniques that they created, like this, you see the circle there where the performers are located in the middle, that's actually called an orchestra, which to us, you think, well, did the musicians play there? No, orchestra, the Greek word for orchestra, actually means dancing place. It's where the chorus would actually do movement. And that chorus could be 50 people. Later on, towards the time of Sophocles, it went down to 12, 15 at certain times. There's a great image of the actual theater of Dionysius. So you can see that orchestra quite beautifully there. So that has come down to us as a rather unique part of every theater. We talk about the orchestra as well. And some of the devices, too, that were used in Greek theater, we still have with us today. The Greeks felt that every play should just take place in front of the palace. So there wasn't a lot of scene changing. There wasn't any attempt to really bring in sets as we like. It was very presentational. The actors stood there wearing masks. Realize, too, these are all men performing the roles of women, and there were many female characters in the play. Euripides, half of his plays were named after women. So we have men performing the roles, so certainly it couldn't be realistic. It was very presentational in almost an oratorical way. The characters kind of spoke out to the audience as if they were doing a speech. In fact, the actors at these theaters often taught public speaking to citizens who then went and spoke at the assembly. So they helped them with their political careers to some extent. But we have devices like the skene, which is a unique building. You can't see it right here in this image. It's crumbled down over the centuries. But in the skene building, that's where the actors would go and change masks. They would grab perhaps a prop, and they would come out into the orchestra to perform. So the skene building eventually became a very elaborate building that was beautifully built. But we also have devices like the mekane. Towards the end of the play, the Greeks had a hard time sometimes figuring out how to end the story. So they would often use this, it looks very primitive in this drawing here, but they would sometimes bring in the god at the end of the play, literally fly the god in on this crane. It's called a mekane, meaning that's in Latin, meaning machine. And it was an attempt to perhaps bring in the final word. So Athena would all of a sudden be brought onto stage and she would say, "Let Orestes go. I declare that he's innocent of the charges." So out of this, we get this famous phrase, Deus ex machina, which is Latin, and it means God from the machine. And it has originated with this idea that at the end of the play, the solution is provided by the entrance of this grand character. It usually is a god. Later on, it became like the king or other civic deities. But by the time we get to our era, this phrase has meant something different, which is a kind of unfortunate way to end the story. Just bringing in the king's messenger and saying, let Macheath go, he's okay. It's kind of like a coincidental or arbitrary conclusion to the story. The Greeks were hopefully not using this as the solution to their endings. In fact, if you look at a great play like Oedipus Rex, what happens at the end of that story, now that's a a famous mythological story, which unfortunately is about a man who finds out that he has unknowingly killed his own father and has been elected to become the king in Thebes, and that means he can marry the queen, and that queen turns out to be his mother. So it is a rather deeply psychological story. Mr. Freud actually came and decided to create the Oedipus complex based on this play. But it is deeply mythological, and it's very much about fate. The Greeks believed in individual freedom, but they also felt that fate carried a strong part in our life. But what happens at the end of Oedipus Rex is that he discovers who was the man who killed the previous king. He finds out it's himself. And Oedipus takes his eyes out. In fact, the way he does that is he goes into the Skene and comes out with another mask that has bloodied eyes to show that he has taken his own eyes out. His wife, who is also his mother, kills herself, and Oedipus is exiled from the kingdom. So that is actually a very climactic ending. There's no deus ex machina involved in that. That was a fully tragic ending. And that, but we still have that famous phrase, deus ex machina, but there was none in the story of Oedipus. Now, when we go to Rome, it's very interesting. Most people think that Greece and Rome shared so much of the same kind of theater. You always put them together as classical theater, Greek and Rome. Their theater couldn't be more opposite in terms of the objectives. Look at this image, for instance. This theater here, which is in Ostia, is a huge marvel of architectural engineering. You can't even see the landscape around you. The Greeks always wanted you to know that you're part of a natural landscape, but the Romans wanted to build these six-story buildings right in the middle of town to kind of let you feel like you were getting away from real life. You could go into an imagined world there and forget about the issues that tear us apart. There was no moral perspective in the Roman theater. In fact, it was all entertainment. These buildings that they built were amazing. After all, the Romans were great builders. Probably their greatest achievement is to build roads all across Europe, some that are still being used. Their aqueducts are phenomenal, 25 miles bringing water to a village. You see all kinds of Roman construction still. This is the Theater of Marcellus, which was a very popular theater. This is a model of the Theater of Marcellus in Rome. But these theaters were not built to gods. In fact, the Romans were very suspicious. They thought if you built it to a god, other gods might get angry, so they didn't want to start any trouble. So if anything, the person who that it was made out for was the emperor. The Romans used theater and many of the arts to kind of push forward their own agenda. Many other leaders have done that quite well, but the Romans seem to be the first or the ones who did it very well. And the plays that were done inside did not have any social reflection. In fact, the characters weren't even from mythology. There's a great image there of another Roman theater in Orange. That's a great image, Ilana. Thank you for bringing that one up. But many of these plays were about everyday life, everyday people, you and me. In fact, the stories were usually about a man who was in love with a woman, but he finds out that his father was in love with the same woman, and it's all about trying to get the fathers to avoid that issue. They were all comedies. There was hardly any tragedies ever written in Rome, unlike in Greece, where it was mainly tragic works. In Greece, at the Theater of Dionysius, you'd have three tragedies written by the same author, and then that same author would write a comedy at the end, a satyr play. But the primary focus was tragedy. In Rome, comedy reigned supreme. So they were totally opposite, if you really think about it. It's amazing how opposite they were. Plays like Plautus's Twin Menechmi, which becomes the source for Shakespeare's Comedy of Errors, which is all about mistaken identity between these two brothers and how it causes so much confusion for the wives, the servants, the mistresses. But it is very funny, but Roman plays are about domestic situations, and that's why they were enjoyed by the Roman populace. And in these theaters, you were sitting with 30,000 people in these huge outdoor theaters, and the actors wore huge masks. They even elevated themselves on catharni so that they stood like 8 feet tall. So it was meant to be spectacle. That's what Roman theater was about, whereas Greek theater was meant to be dramatic. It was meant to bring you into the intensity of what was happening between the characters. So it's almost like Greek and Roman theater, which is so totally opposite, you almost can't compare them. That image that you're seeing right now is called a Skene frons, and now you just see the brick behind it, but it was covered with all kinds of colonnades and sculptures and beautiful images, but the main people who it was emblazoning there were the emperor. There weren't gods, it was the emperor who was the main character, the main focus of attention. So yes, Greek and Roman theater, it tells us a little bit about our own desire to have plays that relate to issues that affect us every day, but at the same time, we do have a lot of Rome in us too. There is the need to kind of get away and just laugh and not worry about having to solve the problems of the world. So in a way, even though they were opposite, you can kind of conclude that both were somehow necessary to society of those times and still to us today. So yes, we have an interesting heritage from the Greek and Roman traditions. So let's talk about directing. What does the stage director do? That's our focus question for today. So I'm hoping to hear from some of you. There are so many functions that the director does that I'd like to take a look at them. And in the chapter on directing, it's one of the things that Wilson really focuses on is just how vast the position is in terms of all the skills that you need to have to be a good director. So first and foremost, I would say that the director needs to be a good audience member. The director has to know, as an audience member does, what you're seeing. So to some extent, you have to know what play to select based on who's going to be coming to your theater to see the show. You can't choose a play unless you know who's coming to see it. And a lot of directing is about avoiding your own self-involvement and thinking what would be interesting to others. So I start with this first because it's very important, and we actually started this class talking about the importance of the audience. Theater is about that interaction between the two. It's not just about the quality of the show itself. It is about a communication that goes on, especially in this live medium. The other thing a director has to be is a playwright to some extent, and not only a playwright, but a critic, someone who understands plays so that you choose the right play for that particular audience, right? And there are three major qualifications that many directors have used. A personal evaluation. In the same way that an actor has to make a strong connection with a role, a director has to love whatever he or she is going to be doing. Even if it's a play that many directors are hired after the play itself is done. So somebody might say to you, listen, we're doing Art of Dining here. Would you like to direct it? They're not going to change the choice. You're stuck with that choice. So you have to find a way to really love that show. It may not have been what you wanted to do, but you have to find a way to have something about it that turns you on. Just like for an actor, you have to have that kind of enthusiasm for it. You also, as a playwright and a critic, need to be able to make a literary evaluation of the show. You have to know its excellence as literature. So, for instance, you have to know what type of play it is, knowing the genre of the play, just as we saw last week. Is it a tragedy? Is it a comedy? Is it a tragic comedy? Is it melodrama? Is it farce? Is it comedy of manners? All those different types. Director needs to be able to identify that. Maybe there's historical categories that you have to understand. And a lot of this helps you to understand the style that you're going to use when you direct it. In the textbook, Wilson talks about how once a spine is found after your interpretation, after your analysis, a second task for the director is to find the style in which the play is to be presented. The concept of style in a theatrical production is difficult to explain. Yes, that is very true, because there's many things that may determine that particular style. He goes on to talk, for instance, about it may be a naturalistic play. Now, naturalism is a kind of super realism where we call it a slice of life. It's almost like you are watching something that's taking place and there's no awareness that there's an audience at all. It's almost like you're looking through a window at somebody else's life. That's a different style than just realism. If you were doing something, he talks about allegory, where a play like Everyman features characters who are named worldly goods, fellowship, beauty. You're playing a kind of large kind of value, and you're not really a human being. So that's a whole different style to be able to direct. And then there's expressionism, where we did a show just a couple years ago, beautifully directed by Naomi Buckley here, called Machinal by Sophie Treadwell. This was expressionistic, and the point she was making was that the modern world, with all of its industry and business, has made us feel alienated. And this particular play was about the effect of industry on women. So it featured sounds of machines and typewriters all through the show, so that you all almost were like unnerved by it. It was expressionistic, going beyond being realistic into a kind of perhaps exaggerated form to make you feel something. So a director needs to know those different genres and how the style is going to be appropriate, what style to use. You need to take a play apart. As we already mentioned, Mr. Aristotle, he actually divided a play into six parts. So the idea of understanding how the play works, the shape of the play, it's kind of like the architecture of how that building was built. That's very important as well. And then thirdly, there's the practical evaluation. This is when a director is taking the idea of, can we do this play? Do we have is it appropriate for the specific audience that we have? Do we have enough actors to do this Shakespearean play that requires 25 people? Do we have enough female roles? I would love to do Richard II here, but there's only one role for a woman, 25 men. How do you do that and not give roles to women? Maybe there's a requirement for a very old character. You need a good person to do King Lear. So there's all of these requirements, scenic requirements. Does it take 15 different sets to do this show? La Cage aux Folles does. So there's a budget aspect to that too. Can we do all that? Does our shop, are we able to build all of those sets? So there's a lot that goes into the decision of what play to do. Your royalties, is it available? You have to pay for the royalties to do a show. So there's a lot to consider. So the director as playwright and as critic is a very valuable function that the director has to partake in. The other thing is the director as an analyst, not a psychological analyst, but someone who knows how to take things apart. The given circumstances, what a director talks about with the actors on the rehearsal floor is the given circumstances. That's basically the who, what, where, when, and why the actions are being done. So it may have to do with social conditions, ethnic influences, environmental influences. So this is what you study. This is what you take apart in a play. Why characters are doing what they're doing based on the action. In fact, a lot of directors look at the action that happened before the play begins, what previous action has happened. So you got to be a good analyst, and of course, you have to analyze character. What my students are going to be doing next week when they analyze a single character in Raisin in the Sun is exactly what the director does for all the characters in the play. In fact, some directors write long essays, paragraphs about the characters so that they understand the objectives that the characters are after, what obstacles stand in their way, some of their character traits, where they're coming from, what background they come from. So all of these factors go into who we are. So obviously it's what would be true of a dramatic character as well. So yes, I think my students are going to find that out next week when they do their Raisin in the Sun exercise. So being a good analyst, being a good researcher, a director also has to be able to see historically and be able to kind of get into the head of the playwright to understand some of the goals that the playwright is writing for. There you see a great image of a playwright kind of going through the explanation of why they would have done this. To be able to identify themes or be able to read the other works that the playwright wrote. That is very valuable for a director to understand how they think. Also, if the play is set in a certain time, 1660s in France, you need to be able to help your cast understand what the artwork was like then, what music was like then, how people dressed then, and obviously how people behaved then, how they walked and moved. And using a snuff box was very popular back then. Don't even know what that is today, right? But an understanding of the culture and the manners of the era, very critical, especially if you're doing a stylistic play from history. So, got to be able to research. You have to be a designer. A director has to understand scene design, costume design, lighting design, prop design, hair design. So there is a lot to be able to enable you as a director to unify the production. That is exactly what your job is, right? To help all these separate designers make sure that the production works in a consistent way, so that the costumes don't seem somehow weird when they're in front of the scenery, or that the lighting doesn't kind of conflict with what's going on with those costumes. So there's a lot that has to be kind of matched up. So you need to know a little bit about design and how to conceptualize. Where you can really help designers is to say, here's kind of the concept that I would like to talk about. The directorial concept that is mentioned in your book quite a lot for directing is a very important term. It's kind of the controlling idea. It's the vision or point of view that the director is going to take on this particular show, because you might be taking a show that's been done hundreds of other times before, but here there's a concept that kind of helps to unify the production. Did a show a couple years ago, I mean, I think this is just a good example, called Boy by Diana Son. Diana Son is a Korean-American playwright. She actually writes for, I think she's producing now, Law and Order. She's had quite a popular career, wrote Stop Kiss, a number of great shows. Anyway, Boy is about a young boy who is an architect. He helps everybody in the town to build their house. So the designer and I kind of wanted to play around with the concept that what if the set was basically the whole house literally, where the audience sits. So what we created was a construction site, and the audience sat in different parts of the construction site, so that there were platforms that the actors actually moved around in, but you always had audience around you, and they were part in the rafters. You could see the rafters in the building. I mean, it was a experimental show. You could do that in a black box theater, as our Edison Theater is. So that kind of experimentalism is great when you have a smaller house. There's only 70 people watching that show. But that is a good example of a directorial concept. Now, someone else could take that same play, Boy, and do it totally differently. Do it as a proscenium show with flats in the background. So a concept is what helps your designers to come up with how they kind of fit into a unified idea. It's often said that the director provides the inner structure of the play and the designers provide the outer structure, what we actually see as a result of that. So yeah, directorial concept, great concept for us to hold on to, and we try to remember what a director really does, and that is a huge part of it. That's how a director provides his or her vision, as we say, a kind of way of looking at this particular play. Okay, another role that the director plays is a manager. To some extent, you have to be able to communicate well. You have to be able to coordinate a lot of what goes on. Auditions need to be very well organized, and that involves with getting the publicity out, setting dates, maybe getting the scripts copied, scheduling a space. There's a lot to be done. And hopefully you have a stage manager that's helping you to do this. And then once you're cast and rehearsing, you need a rehearsal schedule. And it's only a very good director who can understand what you can accomplish in an hour on a particular scene. You don't want to spend that hour only doing a three-page scene when there's other areas that need to be looked at too. So what you can accomplish in that 6 weeks of rehearsal, where maybe you're rehearsing a good 3 or 4 hours a night for 5 nights, and how you can structure it so that the actors are supposed to have their lines down maybe midway, and now you're practicing not having book in hands, but actually interacting. So you have to set all those deadlines as to what happens where. That's vision itself. It sounds boring how to do a rehearsal schedule, but it really does tell us how we are going to get there. It's the plan of action that's going to put this vision in some kind of shape for the audience to see. Running a rehearsal, making sure you don't just stand there and talk to the actors, but make sure you get the actors to do the work that'll get them to know what the scene is about, and getting the best from them, as well as from your stage managers, your designers. And that has a lot to do with being able to create a positive atmosphere that allows everybody to do their work. Another thing that a director has to be is an administrator. You have to know how to handle publicity, public relations. There's a great example of many of the different posters that are created that have to reflect the particular view of the director on this show that we're going to see. So that's a great image there. How to manage the house, how to make sure the ushers know what to do. And then there's budgetary considerations. So as an administrator, there's a lot that also is working in. But the most essential part of what a director does is to be the stager, the person who puts the show on its feet, as we say. This is having to do with composition, being able to arrange actors on a set so that it says something. It's actually a particular relationship suggested. And it has a lot to do with knowing the principles of art, as well as how people relate. So visual composition is an important part of the staging that goes into a show. A director's tool for underscoring the meaning of a scene is how you arrange the physical proximity of one actor next to another. You know, that famous phrase, every picture tells a story? Well, that's what directors on live theater have to do. They have to make an arrangement so that we see what is happening. Case in point, I mean, if you have a father standing over the kitchen table and there sits the son and he's kind of eating his cereal, it kind of shows a domination of dad over the boy, right? So that picture tells a story, and that's exactly what directors do when they try to put compositions that are somehow revealing, and it actually reveals it to the actors. So in addition to that, you also want to give them movement that tells us a lot about who they are. So when you have blocking, this is a word that refers to the positioning of actors on stage, but also how they move from one point to another. You know, it's been said that as soon as a character enters on stage, we have to see who they are. And that's usually a good director who knows how to give them movement that somehow tells a story. So that they are, let's say they have no words to say. How could they non-verbally show who they are? Maybe it has to do with the situation, that the character is in a rush right now, so they have to kind of run in to that entrance. Tells you information about the character. So movement, as Martha Graham, the famous dancer, said, never lies. Movement never lies. It always tells you what's going on with a person internally. So blocking is a great phrase that we use to show what the director provides. One of the greatest blocking artists in the history of theater was the Duke of Saxe-Meiningen, Georg II. This slide here is an image of Julius Caesar, the play Julius Caesar, that Georg II directed, and he was famous for his crowd scenes. He evidently was able to give everybody in that crowd particular character traits, and you would see them by how they move, so that a whole scene kind of came alive in the way that he blocked it. By blocked, we're saying, you know, you stand there and I want you to look down at this person who's kneeling there and this person does this. So blocking is setting up all of those pictures and how people move when they cross down right to the window and then look out. So all of that movement is what we in the theater call blocking. It's stage business, and sometimes directors will pre-block. In other words, they plan ahead of time what they're going to do before they get into the rehearsal hall. And then there are a lot of directors who go in and just do it organically with the actors. They kind of just work it out there on the rehearsal floor. That's a pretty sophisticated director who can do that. But Georg II was the true example of an ensemble director. He was able to do these wonderful group scenes. And finally, before we take our break, I want to talk about the director as an actor. And this is the one that most everybody knows about, that a director at least should be someone who knows how to get the best out of their actors, who knows how to talk to actors in ways that they will be able to do their best work. So it has to do with perhaps understanding conflict, being able to point out to the actors how this scene is very much about two people going at each other and what exactly that conflict is and how the actors can best fight it out. Not that it's a fight scene like that. Conflict for actors is kind of defined as one person has one objective, another person has a different objective, and those objectives are obstacles to each other. So once you help actors to define that, it brings out the tension of scenes, it brings out the sense of suspense for the audience too, when you have that conflict to rely on. A good director understands that there's a time where the acting can be over the top. All right, and sometimes where that's appropriate. Obviously, if you saw Jim Carrey's The Mask and a number of other shows that Jim Carrey has done, that's part of his style, that he goes way over the top, right? So in some cases, it's appropriate, but a good director knows when we're trying to present something that is realistic, that we don't want to go too over, and we don't want to be also at the same time on the other side too internalized. By that, we mean that the actor is working on getting genuine feelings for the scene, but they're so private that the audience isn't getting it. So to be able to balance those two things of having overacting versus internalized acting, that's a great skill as a director, to be able to know how to get a scene that's going to be natural, organic, spontaneous, alive. It's a strange word to use, but when we're watching live theater, that's what we enjoy. The idea that it seems like it's happening right now for the very first time, even though these actors have done it 30 times before, it looks like it's got a sense of immediacy, is one of the words that we use for that. So working with actors, very, very important skill, and that is part of I think the biggest part of what a director needs to be is someone who works well with the actors to help them develop character work. In other words, so that they have a sense of style on stage that allows an audience to see who they are. Character work is having a sense of style. So when you are performing Mrs. Malaprop in this restoration comedy, and you're dressed in these very elaborate costumes, that the actor can deliver a kind of exaggerated style of speaking that goes very consistently with who that character is. So character work and creating genuine emotions. That's an art that is very, very important to a director. And last thing before we take our break is relationship. Oddly enough, a lot of directors and actors get totally focused on character to the point that they don't create a sense that this is a father and a son, and that relationship has to be clear. You don't just work separately, like I'm on one island and you're on another island. You have to create a believable, to create a sisterhood on stage between two women. It takes the work of sculpting the scene so that what's being done on stage says they seem like sisters, don't they? The audience wants to recognize that quality in them. So relationship is something that the director is more responsible for than the actors. After all, the actor is pretty much working on their own self character, right? But a good director helps you to link with that other person so that we're getting a full relationship as well. All right, I think we should take a break, but that just gives you an idea of just how varied all the functions of a director are. And what kind of a person does that well? You have to be a unique kind of individual to be able to handle all those different requirements. So let's take a little break here because I want to bring in a guest who's going to talk to you about directing. And Kelly Herman has done so many wonderful shows for us here. She's had a long career at Laguna. So we'll talk about a little of that. So if you'd like to meet a really terrific director, tune in after our short break here to meet Kelly Herman. And we'll talk a little bit more about Theater 100.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it the results are better academics, more social, better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Zanaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Hi everyone, welcome to Theater 100. This is my wonderful guest, Kelly Herman, who has agreed to come and talk about directing here, and she's a perfect candidate to do this because of all the shows you've done for us, and Kelly will tell us a little bit about some of the shows that she's done at Laguna. So tell me, how did it begin for you? How did you get involved in theater? What made you want to do this crazy world of acting? I mean, you do a lot of acting as well as directing, but today's main focus is on directing.
I started off as a performer and realized in performing that I actually had good vocabulary to talk to other actors. Mm-hmm. And then someone offered me a directing gig that paid, and I went,
"Whoa!"
I'm like, "All right, I get paid for
can't say
working
no
with
that.
Yeah, I can't say no." So I did it, and it was horrible. It was a dismal failure, but I also realized that it was something that I could love and grow into. So that's kind of how I fell into it.
So, like, would you say, tell us a little bit about some of the shows that you've done. Like, what did you do at Laguna?
I did a lot of musicals. I did, primarily it was children's theater. That's what I, that's what I do. And I worked with children, but I also worked with professional actors, and that was a lot of fun.
So what was involved, for instance, in doing a show at Laguna? Like, any examples you can think of that you did there?
Well, you know, I was there during the economic downturn, and mm-hmm. so we had to get very creative. So we got very creative at operating with nothing. Mm-hmm. So I learned good resourceful directing. So, you know, if you need a tree, go out and find branches on the ground and then glue leaves to it. Mm-hmm. I mean, whatever you need to do.
And so, like, would you have a cast of 10 kids in the show or, like, 50?
No. Is it... Oh, good Lord, no. No. I try to keep it true to the script that I'm given and how am I best going to serve the story. Mm-hmm. So I find that with the larger cast, and I have worked with larger casts, that it becomes basically you're herding cats. And I am not that type of director. I do not want to work with 50 kids and having to make sure that they're doing their homework, and then my professional actors are not being distracted by the kids. And so I usually stay very true to the script. That doesn't mean that I don't increase an ensemble size if it supports the story in a way that's cohesive and that I find intriguing, mm-hmm. and works well for the students as well as the adult actors. So pedagogically, is it good? Is it solid? So that's kind of how I worked.
Kelly, I'm sure the students would be curious to know, where did you study? Like, what schools did you go to?
Well, you guys are in for a huge treat. I studied at Cal State Long Beach with
Bill I forgot about that.
So I was at Cal State Long Beach for my undergrad, and then I went to Rutgers Professional Actors Training Program in New Jersey for my graduate work, and then I launched into actually a very successful performance career. And then I segued into managing a touring company for children's touring shows, and then helped develop and grow a program at a theater that was not interested in developing their program and realized the value of it, because people will always support children's theater.
That's great. So. Before you get to children's theater, though, I would love for you to tell them a little bit about what it was like to be at graduate school back at Rutgers, and being—I mean, you were focused on acting, right?
Yeah, 100%.
Was that your main program? Yeah. So, like, what was the process that they put you through in terms of?
Oh my goodness.
maybe that's a bad memory.
No, it's not. No, it's not. What was it like? It was a lot of stripping down filters and removing filters that exist as protective mechanisms in day-to-day life. Because as an actor, a filter is death. You cannot work with, because you have to be completely available to whatever's coming toward you, listening and responding in an organic way, much like you would do in your family situation, you know, the things that fly out of your mouth when you're talking to your parents. Just saying. Or your siblings, or your friends. So getting rid of that, and then part of Rutgers' work was the Meisner technique, which is used by, well, Sam Rockwell, who just got nominated for an Academy Award. He studied the Meisner technique with actually the teacher that I studied with. So it's good actors training.
Can you give them a quick version of what is the Meisner technique? I'm not sure students are aware of what the Meisner technique is.
Meisner technique is listening and responding, and Sanford Meisner came out of the group theater, and there was a lot of controversy within and conflict within the group theater regarding what the method was and how it was going to affect. And I'm sure Bill has talked to you about the method and Stanislavski and all of that, or if he hasn't, he will. Mm-hmm. And so Meisner developed a technique that is living truthfully under imaginary circumstances. So he thought it was less damaging for people psychologically to use your imagination. And I can imagine a great and profound loss. I can, and as an actor, I can plant that in my body, and then all I have to do is listen to the other person in the scene. Mm-hmm. And it will come up because my imagination has already put me there.
That's wonderful. I mean, remember the last thing I was talking about was the director as an actor, and that this is an actor talking, right? I mean, you can tell that Kelly has that sensibility that would make her ideal to work with actors. But I do want to just piggyback on one thing that you said that I think is very unique, and I think our students would be fascinated with this. Removing the filters, what a great way to look at actor training, that somehow we're undoing what society has done to us. I mean, after all, when you're at the dinner table as a young lad or lass, you're not supposed to be speaking up, right? You're supposed to be quiet. There's so many supposed to be's that we learn in terms of just surviving in our schools or whatever. So actors have to learn how to undo all that, and now develop a voice where they can speak out openly and use their hands where they weren't allowed to before. So it is kind of a unique concept that you're removing the filters. That's part of what acting training is all about.
Yeah, it is. We get so used to saying what we think other people want to hear, and that's not to say that that doesn't happen on stage, but a big part of the Meisner technique is is having the subtext that's what's actually really going in. So if you see your friend and they're like, they have the ugliest sweater in the world on, and you go, they go, what do you think of my sweater? And you'll go, it looks great. I'm not telling the truth, because the subtext underneath is like, dang, you should have taken that sweater back. Mm-hmm. So it's the subtext, mm-hmm. but the truth is I don't like the sweater.
That's a great way of putting it. Well, now we're asking our audience here, what is the most enjoyable part of being a director? But I'm going to ask you the hardest question, which is, what is for you the most difficult part of directing?
I love to direct, but the hard part for me is I'm married and I love my husband and I love spending time with my husband and I have a dog and I like to walk my dog. It's the time away from my home, because that's the place where I recharge my cells, my energy cells, and kind of get everything going again. And, you know, it's that time away from home. Mm-hmm. However, that being said, I love doing the process. That's the most difficult part.
I'd be curious, give our students a little idea of what kind of time away is that? I mean, they might be thinking, oh, so for 2 weeks you don't see your husband for dinner? Is that what you're talking about?
It's
Why don't you give them an idea of what goes into doing a show? Even if it's just a straight play, no musical, what would that be like?
Well, I'm getting ready to direct a show at Laguna Playhouse, and my process, I had to reread the book that the play is based on. I'm doing Little Princess for Laguna Playhouse. So I reread the book, and I've already started talking to the costume designer. I've already sent messages to the set designer. And the show doesn't go up till May, but I've already put in probably, I don't know, a month's worth of work, mm-hmm. Designing a rehearsal schedule. And this is all before I even cast the show, looking at the sides. Those are what the actor, when they're auditioning, will hold in their hands, and it has the text on it. So they'll have a scene with another mm-hmm. actor. And I have to pull that material so that I can match people up chemistry-wise. So all that's just before we even walk into a rehearsal hall. And once my rehearsals start, I rehearse 6 days a week. Because it is semi-professional, that means I'm rehearsing in the evening. So I will put in a full day here teaching and my other jobs. And then I will go there from 7 to 9:30, and it's an hour commute home, so I'm home at 10:30. And then on Saturdays, it's from 11 to 3:30 in the afternoon.
So for how many weeks?
This will be a 5 week from start to finish, mm-hmm. to when we tech.
When you say finish, you're talking about the performance that opens.
Yes.
And then it plays for how long?
It runs 2 weekends, 2 solid.
So you're going to be involved in the performance as well. So
yes.
It's not just 5 weeks, it's seven.
It's 13 performances.
So really, when you add it up, we're talking about well over 120 hours of rehearsal. Right, that you're there as well.
Easily.
As your daytime job. So
yeah,
I hope your husband's feeding the dog.
I know, I hope he is too. She needs to, the vet says she needs to trim down, so.
But just to be aware of that it really is time away from your loved ones. We don't usually tend to think about it in that way, but it really is to some extent a bit of a lonely job. And it's, you are on one side of it all. The show is up there, and you're kind of like separate. So it can get a little lonely. That's for sure. That is a very difficult part of directing. So I'm glad you brought that up. That's
it's one of those things
that's
that
one of the downsides of it.
Yeah, there's people sometimes don't look at it that it is time away, and that's probably the bigger sacrifice, because when you're working on a project and it's all consuming, life is going on around you, and time passes, and you're like, oh wow, mm-hmm. All of a sudden my niece is graduating from high school this year. I'm like, how did that happen? Mm-hmm. How did that happen? So it's that stuff.
Yeah, yeah, it makes things go pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Tell me, so that we don't get confused, because we're going to talk about The Little Prince, which is a production that Kelly just did for us in the fall of 2017. It was very successful. But how is The Little Princess different? Because it's not the same story, right? Isn't this a classic story that has nothing to do with the Exupéry story?
No, it has nothing to do. So it is by Hodgson, who wrote, it's a children's book. Laguna primarily does books that are based on literary works. And it is about a little girl that's very wealthy that is left in a seminary for girls, and that's a girls' school, a boarding school, and her father dies. And she is reduced from being very wealthy to having to work in the house. And what keeps her going is her imagination, which is the biggest gift that we have, is our imagination. Mm-hmm. So that it's a lesson about kindness. It is a lesson about friends and who our true friends are. It's a lesson about family and what makes family. And then it is, you know, when you have an imagination, you really don't need, I mean, it's nice to eat and sleep and all that, but mm-hmm. it's what will fuel you and keep you going.
It's a little like The Secret Garden, right?
It is. It's by the same author.
Same author, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so it's a great children's classic.
It is.
But I want to talk about the classic that you did for us, which is The Little Prince,
yes.
which most everybody knows the story of The Little Prince. It's a wonderful novel that came right out of the war years of France, 1940s. But you would never know it because it is such a lovely tale. Can you tell us a little bit about what may have first of all been the impulse to want to do? Why would you want to do The Little Prince? We tend to do shows like I'm telling them about Before It Hits Home, which is about AIDS in the African American community. We've done shows that kind of hit home with some of the issues that college students go to. So why would we do The Little Prince?
I think it deals with the same issues. Little Prince deals with what happens to us as we grow up, and it goes back to what we were talking about earlier, that feeling of we lose track. We get one shot at this life, and that's kind of how we rolled with it with the cast that I was working with. We have one shot, and you can be your authentic self and do what you love and make it work and be true and let your imagination and creativity bubble to the surface and let that live within you and you will find your way. Or you can listen to what other people tell you and then you don't have your most authentic journey. Mm-hmm. And so with Little Prince, the aviator is not living his authentic life. He has become isolated. He is not engaged with other people. And then he crashes his plane in the desert and this little boy is there. And he engages him and he teaches him that the gift that he was given, which is the gift of drawing, is his authentic self.
Now, this is not realistic. This little boy that all of a sudden appears in the middle of this desert, how could this little boy be able to survive? It's the Sahara.
It's the Sahara.
It's the Sahara, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's identified as a specific desert, but you get the feeling like you're in another planet. I mean, it really is a sense of aloneness that the navigator goes through. And then all of a sudden, there's this little boy who is just so willing to talk, never talk about, oh, I'm feeling thirsty, I'm gonna die or anything here. So we're in a different kind of world. It's a very imagined world that Antoine Saint-Exupéry, who wrote the actual first novel, created. But tell us, what version is this? Now, how is this different? I mean, because this is obviously, we have a musical here that we're looking at.
That's true. It was a musical. I go about my musicals the way I direct musicals differently than a lot of people, because I am less concerned with how the music sounds coming out of. What I go for is the truth of what the intention is, what the character wants from the other person. And so when you're really happy, sometimes you'll sing. Or when you're sad, or you hear a sad song, it'll evoke an emotional life. Mm-hmm. So it has the music that acts in a narrative way for the most part within the course of this, but it also explains what emotionally is going on with these particular characters on this particular journey. And so part of it is the aviator's memory, and part of it is the little prince's memory, and then the question arises, is the little prince actually the aviator and the youth within the aviator that he is allowed to be suppressed and pushed away? And in finding him, Is he able to re-engage that aspect of himself? It's kind of a head trip, sorry, but that is kind of how it rolls.
But it is, that's the beauty of the show. It's almost like the aviator has kind of come to the end of his life. He has no more inspiration, and this event that happens kind of releases his new enthusiasm for life. The little boy has to somehow play a role as a catalyst in his life. So it's quite life-affirming, very touching. But let me go back to the first question. How did you do so far? How did you do the desert? I mean, and where did you do this play? Like, what does the audience see when they walk in?
They see our small Edison Theater, which is delightful, and the set was kind of on. We called it the diamond, and it was shaped. The audience was here on would be the right side, and then kind of on the left side, but it was touching. It was kissing like that. And the action took place in this area, almost what I would call a modified thrust, because it wasn't quite the thrust with the audience being on three sides. It was really only on two, but it had that feeling. And the space is extremely intimate, so the actors didn't have to be mic'd, which I loved, because I think that's a horrible cheat.
Yeah, if we're only talking about 60 people sitting in like kind of a like an L arrangement here, yeah. There's like two or three rows, so they're kind of creating a kind of rectangle, and then there's these drapes that kind of enclose the space and create a kind of desert-like feeling.
Well, it's the way they were lit, and Fred DePonte did the lighting, and the lighting was exquisite. I mean, without the lighting, it would have just looked kind of... It would have looked kind of bland, but he added this element along with the costumes, who were designed by Karen Jacobs, and the set by Evan Bartoletti. It kind of encapsulated this world in a really lovely way, because I wanted the set to be very, very simple, because as children look at it, they fill in the blanks. So they're activating the launch sequence in their own head. And that's also why I'm Bill did not bring this up. The little prince is actually a puppet.
Well, I was just going to bring that up because, I don't know if you were listening earlier, but we were talking about directorial concept.
Okay.
Kelly did an amazing thing with this show. You could have a little boy, you know, cast a little boy in the role, but look at what she did. Here's a wonderful picture with the little prince and the rose. Why don't you describe what we're seeing here when we look at the little prince?
The little prince, I wanted him to reflect our demographic here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And traditionally, he is done as a little French boy with blonde curly hair and very, very white. And I'm like, that is not relatable to our world today as much as a child that would reflect a myriad of different groups. And so he got created out of like a giant rag doll, and he attached to the actress who played him, and that was Paisley Rose Carswell, and attached to her, and then she manipulated the body and gave him life. So it was almost like she was channeling through the puppet the life force.
So in cases like we're watching on this image right here, Vanessa, who plays the part of the rose, if you can imagine Vanessa in that outfit as a rose, she actually was quite wonderful in the role. She is looking at the puppet's face when they interact. She's not looking at Paisley, the actress, who is manipulating the puppet. I mean, it really goes back to the Bunraku concept of Japanese puppetry, where you have three manipulators who are actually operating a puppet. But here, what do you feel you gain by having that arrangement for the little prince, a puppet there operated by that manipulator?
I don't know. It creates a different type of magic, and it creates a different type of theatrical experience for the audience and for the performers. So my idea was that I knew I was probably 100% confident that we weren't going to get this magical little boy showing up to auditions. I was 100% sure.
So
that
solution was practical, huh?
It was in the practical component. However, I also always want to push my actors to step beyond what is easy for them. And in doing this, this pushed the actress to use her body in a completely unique and atypical way. That so it took her outside of her comfort zone. So she was having to sing, act through this puppet, and her growth was unbelievable.
That's a great point. I mean, if you could bring up like this image that we have of the navigator and the puppet, that's a great image. Now there's Paisley behind, and Paisley has to kind of let the audience see what's happening to the puppet. So in order to enliven the puppet, she's got to be very expressive, right? Because when she moves her right arm, the right arm of the puppet comes up. When she moves her left arm, she's attached, right?
Oh, yeah.
And so she's up on her feet, showing us literally what the puppet's going through as the other actors. This is the navigator. This is Nick Gednoff playing the navigator. But you can see how the interactions are between the characters and the little prince puppet.
Yes.
He's not looking at Paisley. He's looking at the puppet. So it provides a kind of unique thing for the audience. You're actually enjoying watching this little boy, but at the same time, you're watching the manipulator, the puppeteer, operating it. It's what live theater brings us, which is the kind of process that goes on with creating it, too.
Yeah, well, people wouldn't buy it if you saw that in film.
Mm-hmm.
No one would buy that.
Right.
But people bought into it, and when my students wrote about it, the big thing they talked about was how much they loved that little puppet. And everyone wanted that puppet. They're like, that puppet is so cute. And he was. And it was all Paisley. It was just a giant doll. Mm-hmm. And Paisley made him a lovable, a magical little boy.
It's very funny when you consider that. Because, I mean, if you had cast a young boy in the role, not every young boy is particularly amiable and likable. I mean, what if you cast someone who didn't carry that through and wasn't that likable by the audience? Then you're really stuck.
I had done a show several years ago, a long time ago now, Island of the Blue Dolphin. Some of you might have read that in elementary. But I designed a puppet for that. Rama was a puppet, and it was manipulated by an adult actor. And it was super successful. When Ramo dies, sorry, that's a spoiler for those of you who haven't read it, but when Ramo dies, fourth graders were crying. They were like, oh my gosh, she's dead. But it was a giant puppet. That's all he was. He was a puppet. But people invest. They want to invest. They want to have their imagination tapped into. And so I knew that it was something that would work if we could make it work. And we did.
You know, we talk a lot about this when actors are working on a moment that has to be real and a very deep feeling of grief or whatever. They sometimes will go back to their past and do a kind of emotional memory. But the imagination is also a great source for feelings.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
And I mean, the case of that you're offering here of a puppet motivating an audience to tears is very, very unique. I mean, that is true in Bunraku in Japan as well. People are out there crying, watching this puppet go through some turmoil. It's funny what we invest and how much of ourselves we commit to this strange, willing suspension of disbelief, you know, that unique aspect of how much the audience participates with their imagination. It's very unique.
If they allow themselves to.
Right.
And
right.
There are
people.
There are people that resist. They're like, I can't buy into that. That's a woman operating that boy puppet. Mm-hmm. But think of how liberating it would be if everyone could just let go and have the experience and enjoy the experience, and see how it affects them, and then ask, how would I have done it differently? Would I have, you know, sent out a different casting notice to get a little boy to show up? Mm-hmm. And then it runs into the same problem. That boy may not be as magical as that puppet for the audience.
Yeah, so. That was so unique. It was so magical just that it was a puppet, an actual puppet there. This image right here is also very telling about the space, too. That gives us a good look at what was the desert there, right? So here's our navigator, Nick, talking to the little prince, and you can see how absolutely expressive Paisley was in all the movements that the little prince was doing. Is this a flying moment? Is he flying?
He is actually mocking the aviator's crash.
The aviator's crash, right?
Yeah, so he's making fun of him. And the audience always loved it because it was such a whimsical and childlike moment where we make, ha-ha, you crashed your plane.
Well, now, Kelly, explain those boxes that we're seeing in the up center there and down right. What are those boxes in the middle of the desert?
So the boxes would be something you might find after a plane crash, and inside of them would hold the props. And so this was just an idea to give people, this also allowed for levels in the space. So I had actors going up and down off those boxes, but it also, they're made out of, they're wood, but then they're covered with rattan so that they have kind of a desert type feel, for lack of a better way.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some hidden magic. In the upstage one, there was a water effect where when they opened it.
Yeah, explain that, because the up center box there, that's right between Paisley and Nick, as you see, there's a moment where the navigator does find water.
They both find water.
They both find water. And how is that done?
Inside there is actual water.
Inside that box?
There was actual little tiny bowl of water. So Nick drinks, but the little prince never drinks because mm-hmm. the little prince knows he's on the final leg of his journey.
Mm-hmm.
But when they lift the lid and they lift it together as friends, they lift it. And inside there was a light that had like this sparkly effect.
Mm-hmm.
And then Evan, then Fred came up with that because I had done that in another show and I loved that effect. And Fred goes, we have that. And so we had the sparkle light. And then Evan put on the lid like a reflective fabric so that when it opened, it sparkled. And I love this part because it's so simple. It's just a light and some fabric. But every night, people were like, oh, because your imagination just is launched. It's launched. You're going to buy that is a giant well sitting on top of the desert. I mean, if you get really analytical, you're like, that doesn't work. But you don't, because you buy into it.
Mm-hmm. You're really pinpointing a lot of what makes theater so unique, is that magic that comes with the audience going halfway to make it really work. It's not all the fabulous illusion we can create with, you know, computer-assisted graphics and all that. It has to do with how much they are actually in the act as well.
My feeling is that if I am doing my job correctly, they are going to become part of the experience. Whether they want to or not, they're going to invest. If I've done my job right, they're going to invest in a way that is authentic and organic for them too. So they're going to have whatever experience that they have as long as they're present. And so that's kind of how mm-hmm. If
that's
they
beautiful.
Laugh or cry, or if they walk out and they're angry and they want a call to action or something like that, then I'm like, I've done my job. Mm-hmm. The story reached them.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
So,
Kelly, explain this moment here too, when we have the navigator sitting down and we've got the little prince. And the little prince, by the way, never gets a name, right? We never hear a name. That's kind of unique that it goes through the whole story and he's just the little prince.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not meant to be realistic to the point that it's a single character. It stands for something much more. It's almost allegorical. What is happening at this moment here?
The prince is asking for, so there's baobabs on his planet. The prince has left his planet, so this is the whimsical part of it. He's left his planet in search of the rest of his journey because he's feeling tied down. A lot like some people get in relationships, but tied down by his relationship with the rose because she's become very demanding. And he's worried about the baobab, so he is asking the aviator to draw him a picture of a sheep to eat the baobabs, because everyone knows that sheep like to eat anything, and they'll pull stuff out by the root so nothing will ever grow there again. So that's what he's asking.
And one of the aspects, could you describe too the projections that were used in this show? I mean, it was another magical part of the show, is that there were this drawing sequence, I think it's this drawing sequence, where we see the drawing come alive.
So we had a student who was in our production workshop, Alexandra Jacobs, Alex is what I'm used to calling her, so I had to think of her whole name. and she did all the projections, and so they were computer animated projections. So as he's practically drawing them, they are showing up on a projection on the wall, on the curtain, and so the audience is seeing them in real time. And she also built the puppet. Mm-hmm. She was our puppet designer.
Which, that process, was that pretty simple, or
no.
Was there?
No.
What little challenges did you run into in creating that puppet?
Well, I, because she is extremely skilled, I kind of said, this is what I want. If you have questions, I have done this before. And so we kind of mapped it out, and then she brought different incarnations of the prince. And then we kind of settled that this is what he was going to look like. And then we were having trouble with him falling forward because he's on stage for the entire play. Mm-hmm. The previous puppet was not on stage for that long that I had built before. So he was in and out fairly quickly. She had came up with a harness for the back so he didn't fall over because he was falling over. And then she experimented with the hair because we wanted the hair to still be gold. And she played with different types of glitter so that with his twists, they would catch the light. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, so the projections and the puppet, Alex Jacobs.
Could you explain a little bit about this image, too, that features our Rose,
yes,
played beautifully by Vanessa Williams, who is actually, oddly enough, a student in this class, in our actual Theater 100 class. She's taking this class right now. I don't know if she's watching the show. But tell us a little bit about what's happening right in this scene.
Well, he's discovering her. And what happens is he's alone on this island, and he has his tasks. He cleans his volcanoes, and he prunes his baobabs. And then there's this new plant that shows up, and he tends it, and he watches it, and then it grows it. It's a little creepy when I'm explaining it. I just realized that sounded a little creepy. But she eventually blooms, and everything is new, and he's experienced with this world, so he's like, no, that's what this is, and that's what this is. And so in this moment, they're establishing their relationship and their friendship, and he is kind of guiding her through the first steps of their relationship.
So now, why didn't you just have her look like a real rose?
Oh, I love that question. I don't do children's theater like most people do children's theater. I try to keep things so that a child looking at it can fill in the blanks and an adult looking at it can fill in the blanks.
Right.
So
like this wonderful image of Vanessa, it shows you a human aspect to the rose, and that is so important to the show.
I think it's really important, and I think that's where a lot of people lose track of what children's theater is, because mm-hmm. children can see a lie. Mm-hmm. So I never want to lie to a child on stage because they can see it.
Kelly, I knew we were going to run out of time too soon. This is terrible, but we're at the finish here, but it was so nice of you to come over and talk about this. This was such a wonderful plus. I'm sorry if anyone missed seeing The Little Prince, but you can tell that when you have a good director, you're in very good hands. So Kelly, thank you for coming and sharing with us. We'll see you guys next week when we talk about Raisin in the Sun. Thank you for joining.
Peace.
That went very well.